Well, the International Workers' Day was marked with a public holiday today. We trust and believe that you enjoyed the Labor Day today. Those of you who are here in Kenya and from wherever you're watching us, both in Kenya and around the world, this is KBC Prime Edition coming to you live from Broadcasting House right here along Harithuku Road. Good evening. My name is Tom Boyer, and here is a summary of our top stories tonight.
The government says a radical remuneration policy is in the offing as Kenyans mark Labor Day.
Mimi mwenyewe niliwaahidi ya kwamba tutakuwa na mpango ambayo itateremusha gharama ya maisha.
The president urges patience to allow economic recovery interventions to yield a reduction in the cost of living. The opposition remains adamant about resuming mass action protests Tuesday as government warns against chaos.
We have established
Speaking at Labor Day celebrations, the head of state spelt out new policies the government was implementing in the labor sector, including enhanced adoption of a remuneration policy that will be responsive to the cost of living. That report opens our coverage tonight.
President William Ruto presided over the national celebrations of the 58th Labor Day held at Uhuru Gardens, imploring workers and their unions to work with the government in growing the economy.
Hawa wafanyikazi walio wachagua, pia hawa wafanyikazi wamenichagua. So we share the employer. Nyinyi mmechaguliwa na hawa, na mimi pia nimechaguliwa na hawa. Sisi wote ni wafanyikazi ya wananchi wa taifa la Kenya. Tushirikiane.
The president said the government was developing a remuneration policy that will harmonize salaries of public workers with those of private sector.
Tuondoe tofauti ambayo iko kati ya wafanyikazi wa umma, wafanyikazi wa private sector. We must harmonize how we treat all our workers.
Labor Cabinet Secretary Florence Bore explained that under the new policy, the determination of wages will take into account the productivity of workers.
This policy champions a fair, equitable, and dynamic mechanism for determination and compensation of wages to all workers in the country that takes into account all necessary parameters, including productivity indices.
The president also rooted for increased statutory deductions such as pension, adding that the National Hospital Insurance Fund contribution will be raised from 500 shillings to 2.5% of the employee's income.
Yule mfanyi, yule ambaye mulikuwa munalipa kwa NHIF shilingi 500, sasa tutateremusha chini ikuje shilingi 300. Kwa wale mmekuwa mkilipa shilingi 500 kuanzia mwezi wa 7 tukikamilisha budget, na mimi ambaye ni rais ambaye nimekuwa nishikilipa shilingi 1000, sasa mimi nitalipa shilingi 27,500, na hao wengine katikati hapo watalipa hapo kidogo kidogo namna hiyo.
On implementation of such reductions, the Federation of Kenya Employers, however, called for prior talks with the government and a grace period for planning.
We therefore ask that before any changes are made, new changes, enough lead time, we are proposing 1 year, be given to businesses to be able to plan, to adjust their budgets and restructure their financial flows.
Even as the president steered off the clamor for minimum wage increment, the employers had pleaded that the economy was still battered, with KOTU boss Francis Atwoli accusing the Salary and Remuneration Commission of overstepping its mandate.
There is another animal which has lived with us, Your Excellency, and this one you must also close your eyes and deal with it. This animal called SRC. That they want to negotiate, they want to decide on CBAs. CBAs are freely negotiated between workers and employers.
Meanwhile, President William Ruto has warned the opposition against destruction of businesses during the anti-government protests that are planned for Tuesday. Speaking while leading the country in marking the 58th Labor Day celebrations, the president said that he will not allow Kenyans' property to be destroyed or lives to be lost, calling on the opposition to instead embrace the bipartisan talks. This coming as the Central Organization of Trade Union Secretary General Francis Atwoli urging workers to shun the protests.
The Labor Day celebration marked at the Uhuru Gardens Monday had its fair share of political theatrics that majorly touched on revived anti-government protest by the opposition slated for Tuesday. With the theme being Kenyan workers for economic growth, political stability and job creation, the tempo for the occasion seems set. The event's host, Central Organization Trade Union Secretary General Francis Atwoli, previously an ardent supporter of Azimio, explaining his change of political stance.
Na sisi tulikuwa na AK-47, tulikuwa na pistols, tulikuwa na uwezo, na tulikuwa na ni, na ukapita kwa sisi na wewe ukuwa na hizo vitu. Sasa, what makes us think that tukienda kwa streets kwa maandamano, we will change the status quo?
He urged the opposition to shelve the demos, saying that would not change the status quo.
There are other situations that are irreversible. Mambo ya Mungu. Na yakisha fanyika, you accept it. Juzi umeappoint mkubwa wa majeshi. Uliappoint inspector general. Umeappoint cabinet. Mtu kukutoa ni shida, atakutana na bunduki mbali sana. So let's not dwell on impossibilities, things that cannot happen.
While discouraging workers from participating in the protest, Atwoli urged the government to reach out to the opposition to reduce the tension in the country. A call that Deputy President Rigathi Gachagua threw back at Atwoli, terming the opposition leaders as his close allies.
Waandalie chakula, na ile vitu mulikuwa munakunywa na hawa, na ile muziki ya Lingala. Mukisha maliza uambie maneno ya kwamba uchaguzi uliisha na rais wa Kenya ni William Samoe.
President William Ruto did not mince his words, warning opposition leaders against disrupting livelihoods and destroying property while exercising their constitutional right to picket.
We also know what democracy looks like. We also know what human rights are. It is nothing to do with violence. It is nothing to do with anarchy.
The president advised opposition leaders to embrace the proposed bipartisan talks instead of the protest.
Sitaruhusu mali ya mwananchi kuharibiwa, biashara ya mwananchi kuharibika, kazi ya mwananchi kuharibika, watoto wetu ati wasiende shule, ati kwa sababu kuna watu wanataka kutulazimisha ati tugawane serikali. That one will not happen.
Azimio has so far issued a notice to Nairobi County Regional Police Commander Adamson Bungei for the demos on Tuesday.
The plan by the opposition to resume its anti-government demonstrations on Tuesday is an indication that they are not satisfied with the bipartisan talks. However, the president has warned against destruction of property. Kamche Menza for Prime Edition at Uhuru Gardens, Nairobi.
The government is on course to reduce the cost of living as it rolls out a series of interventions to navigate the current economic challenges. President William Ruto, during his May Day address to the country, said economic recovery is a gradual process that will not automatically drop through the unga shelf prices alone. Here's that report.
President William Ruto has told the country that it will take time to lower the prices of basic commodities.
We must continuously work on reducing the cost of living. Mimi mwenyewe niliwaahidi ya kwamba tutakuwa na mpango ambayo itateremusha gharama ya maisha. Na hiyo mpango watu wengine hawaelewi. Unga sio ya kwamba inapunguzwa bei ati kwa shelf. unga inaanza kupunguzwa bei kwa kumsaidia mkulima shambani azalishe chakula ya kutosha, ndio chakula ikue kingi, ikifika pale sokoni iwe bei yake imepungua.
The government has been under immense pressure to cushion Kenyans against the sharp rise in the prices of basic commodities.
Your Excellency, through prudent management and well thought out interventions, you have successfully brought down the cost of unga from an all-time high of 230 shillings to slightly above 150. It is true, it is in between 150, 170, depending on where you buy.
The 2023 Labour Day was marked against the backdrop of some disquiet from a section of Kenyans over the government's modus operandi in handling the problem. According to the Kenya National Bureau of Statistics, the country's inflation rate dropped to 7.9% in April from 9.2% in March. Data showed that prices of commodities such as maize flour, sugar, potatoes, and beans dropped by 1.6%, 1.9% and 7.2%, and 5% as the effects of the prolonged drought and importation challenges are slowly eased.
Coming out of today's Labour Day celebrations, the government's call to Kenyans is patience as it looks to recover the economy from turmoil. Alan Aoko, Prime Edition.
Kenyans joined the world in celebrating Labour Day as they hoped for an increase in the minimum wage to cushion them from inflation. Union workers led their fellow workers with their tools of trade at a colourful national celebrations that were held at the Uhuru Gardens right here in Nairobi, Kenya.
Hundreds of Kenyans braced light morning showers to attend this year's Labour Day celebrations, a day set aside to honour and celebrate the contribution of workers in national building. Labour Day has a unique history dating back to 1st of May 1886, when trade unions in the United States of America decided to go on strike demanding 8 hours of work per day to shelve the remaining 8 for recreation and 8 for resting. Celebrating the day, melodious tunes rent the air at Uhuru Gardens venue for the national celebrations. Different groups of workers displayed their tools of trade, elaborately explained through an array of colorful banners of all kinds. White praised workers for their tireless efforts while calling for unity in nation building. The Vitimbi comedy group performed a skit befitting the day. Koto Secretary General Francis Atole tickled the crowd with a peep into his personal life.
Mimi sio kijana hata kama mnaona Mary bibi yangu ni moyangu. Mary kazi yake kwangu ni kuangalia socks nimevaa namna gani, shati yangu yuko sawa sawa, saa ya kumesa dawa ikifika ni saa ngapi, heri anaweka hiyo diary. Because tukiandika mtu mwingine tuseme ni personal assistant atatuibia.
Archbishop Arthur Kitunga seemed to have read the workers' hunger for better wages and made a supplication on their behalf.
Mulango mpya unafunguka na malaika wa amani wanatumwa kutoka juu mbinguni washuke katika Kenya mpaka Kenya ishangae. Tunawaombea hata wale wanatuona kwa media na watu wote tuseme amen. Amen.
But even though these prayers were not answered instantly, the future is not that gloomy if the president's undertaking on a new remuneration policy and a review of the workman's compensation policy are anything to go by.
Well, as Kenya joins the world to mark the Kenya 58th Labour Day celebrations, both the formal and informal sectors now hope that the policies deliberated upon on this particular day will be implemented. Serafina Robi for Prime Edition at Uhuru Gardens, Nairobi.
Well, that story brings us to our fast break right here on Prime Edition. And when we come back, reactions on the Shakahola grave matter, Azimio demos that are coming up also, plus the cabinet. Remember, it's a Monday, so we feature the cabinet. We'll be back shortly. Do stay with us.
What am I forgetting? Nini. Workers paid. Rent checked.
Mlango
locked.
Visiting out of
business.
Internet sorted.
What is it? What am I forgetting?
What? Nini. Nimesahau kucheza Lotto Moto.
Usisahau kucheza Lotto Moto. Unaweza shinda hadi milioni mbili kwenye M-Pesa. Chagua lipa na M-Pesa. Paybill number, weka 7577. Account number, weka neno Lotto. Weka kiwango chochote cha pesa kuanzia shilingi 50 hadi 2000. Lipa kisha subiri draw. Jumbe huu umeidhinishwa na BCLP.
Every Monday evening we take you back where the action happened live. We'll let you know what you missed, even if you were present.
And our goal is to continue supporting our own.
From the latest celebrity buzz,
fashion,
music,
and all manner of youth talent,
the grapevine cameras rove all week to bring you the latest in the enormous entertainment scene.
Watch Grapevine every Monday at 10 p.m. and the rerun on Tuesday at 2 p.m. only on KBC Channel 1, baby.
Engage us on Facebook and Twitter, hashtag Grapevine on KBC. Let us know what is happening in your area code, because you know what they say, if you did not see it on Grapevine,
then it most probably never happened. Bah!
Ain't nobody gotta tell you what you gotta do.
Welcome to Take on Tech. This is the show that keeps you updated on everything you need to know about technology.
First of all, the women that are already in tech should be empowered.
I've actually studied electrical and electronics engineering, telecommunications option. So basically, I'm in the tech sector.
The government should empower the girl child in a way that they should venture so much into ICT.
There's never a dull moment with us. Tune in every Monday from 10:30 p.m. only on KBC Channel 1.
Welcome back, Interior Cabinet Secretary Professor Kithure Kindiki. Monday launched the commencement of the autopsies for the 110 bodies of the victims of controversial Pastor Paul Mackenzie's cultist teachings. Kindiki said it would take 1 week for the exercise to be completed, but it will take relatives of the victims more than 1 month to know the identities of the bodies through the DNA technology.
The post-mortem examination exercise led by Chief Government Pathologist Johansen Oduor, assisted by detectives from the Homicide Unit of the Directorate of Criminal Investigations and forensic experts, among others. Addressing journalists at the Malindi Sub-County Hospital mortuary, Professor Kindiki urged members of the public to be patient as the government embarks on the process to establish the truth about the Shakahola massacre.
The team here assures the people of Kenya that we don't expect to take more than 1 week to be able to discharge examination of all the 110 bodies which are in this mortuary.
Kindiki adding that the government had resorted to using modern technology to conduct the rescue and recovery operation in the 800-acre piece of land. The Interior CS named Assistant Inspector General of Police Peter Ndungu as the operation commander, supported by the Regional Police Commander.
An action that must be taken against any public officer whose action, inaction, failure, or outright negligence could have caused the deaths that have occurred on our people.
The Church and the Clergy Association of Kenya, in the meantime, calling for the implementation of the proper regulations of the churches in Kenya to weed out cults that pose as churches.
We want to advise the government not to deal with a few individuals, but consult widely. There are several umbrella bodies in this country, so they should involve all the leaders of all umbrella bodies, but not a few, because that will divide us. We will support a process that is inclusive.
The association is urging that proper structures be put in place to restore order in the churches and speed investigations be conducted to bring culprits to justice. Michael Mandiga for Prime Edition, Nairobi.
An update on the Azimio demos. The government and the opposition are tonight locked in an impasse over an impending fresh round of mass demonstrations set for Tuesday. On Monday, Deputy Inspector General of Police Noor Gabor declared the planned Azimio protests unlawful, even as opposition chief Raila Odinga insisted that the march is on. And as Zainab Said reports, the two sides appear headed on a coalition course, with Azimio on one hand insisting that it must deliver its position, while the police on the other maintaining that they will stop the march to avert the destruction of property. Here's our report.
Nairobi Regional Police Commander Adamson Bungei outlawed Tuesday's planned demos. Deputy Inspector General of Police in charge of administration, Noor Gabor, has maintained that Azimio has no authority to continue with its planned march. Gabor warned that the government will not allow any form of demos in the country, arguing that it poses a grave threat to national security. But the opposition is adamant that the police have no authority to outlaw their right to picket and petition the government. Raila Odinga is calling on his supporters to heed the call and insisted that Tuesday's march will be peaceful. Previous demos by the opposition have been met with resistance from the police, who have on every occasion restricted the opposition's march to sections of the capital city.
There will be no destruction of people's properties. Our people have been told to be peaceful. They're not even going to go to where people's places are. We're not going to markets. We're not going to shops. You say you're going to assemble at the Central Park in the city of Nairobi and march to the IBC headquarters and present a petition there. March to the office of the president along Uhuru Highway and present a petition. And also go to the Treasury buildings. There are no businesses along those streets. So therefore, nobody should come up with the excuse that they're going to protect people's properties tomorrow.
Raila Odinga has in the meantime weighed on the unfolding events in Shakaola, Kilifi County, saying it is only Parliament with the advice of the Judicial Service Commission that can establish a tribunal to investigate the incident. For Prime Edition, I'm Zainab Said.
Motorists plying the Narok Mahi Mahiu Highway have decried huge losses following the closure of the busy road Sunday by the Kenya National Highway Authority. The decision was reached after the road developed cracks a few kilometers from Mahi Mahiu town. The motorists are now calling on Kenha to construct flyovers along the busy highway to avert further losses.
The operators led by Narok Line Service Chairman Andrew Mwangi said they made over 400,000 shillings in losses on Sunday alone, as all the vehicles that operate the route kept off the highway.
Jana tulipoteza 1400. Sasa leo hatujui tutapoteza nini. Juu sasa magari yakunywa diesel, magari yabebi abiria. Hivi sasa saa hii kutoka Narok, kazi iko chini sana juu watu wengi wanajua wakija hapa either walale ama warudi tena. Kwa hivyo usafiri uko chini sana.
Kutafuta gari ya kutupeleka pale Mai Mahiu imekuwa ni shida. Wasafiri wengi wenye wanatumia hii barabara saizi wanateseka sana, manake kwenye huko kwenye wanatumia huko ni wanaingia huko reserve na huko kumeharibika sana juu ya mvua kubwa yenye inaendelea kunyesha.
Hata kama ni kazi ya boda saa hizi hata abiria ashuke awekwe na gari hapa kwenye unamzungusha inabidi mzungushe zaidi ya kilomita 10 na kumuitisha hiyo pesa tena ni baraka.
The drivers who have now been forced to use a diversion as they approach Mai Mahiu town called on the Kenya National Highway Authority to construct flyovers along the busy highway.
Hii mutaro hata sasa wakichimba na waweke mawe ni kazi ya bure. Ile kitu ingetakiwa ni watengeneze daraja kama mita 50 kutoka mita 100 kutoka pande ile nyingine na pande nyingine hii barabara ipite juu. Ule miaka ingine iliyopita hapa tu bado wanatengeneza hapo tu ndio waliweka mawe na hapo tu ndio bado imepasuka.
Kenha has advised motorists to use Narok Kisiriri Mau Summit Njoro Road to join Nakuru and other destinations and Narok Bomet Kaplong Road and connect to Kaplong Kericho Road. Jacqueline Masharia for Prime Edition.
More families in Nyando and Kadibo areas in Kisumu County will have to spend the nights in the cold due to floods after River Nyando burst its banks following heavy rains being experienced in different parts of the country. The number of households affected has risen from 1,500 on Sunday all the way up to 4,500. Tilio Marco reports.
The flood situation is getting worse by the day in Nyando and Kadibo areas of Kisumu County as long as rains continue pounding the area. More families are being displaced even as they counted losses on their acres of rice, maize, sugarcane and other crops that are now submerged by water. At Ombaka in Nyando sub-county, hundreds of residents are stranded along the road with the little household items they could salvage as they ponder their next move. St. John Nyamasau Primary School, Ombaka Dispensary and Ogenya Primary School are some of the institutions submerged in water. The situation is not different at Ogenya in Kadibo sub-county, where several homes have been marooned by floods. Kisumu Acting County Commissioner Hussein Alanson Hussein, who led the County Disaster Management Committee team to assess the impact of the floods, said evacuation centers have been established at Ombaka and Ogenya to house the affected victims as efforts to get humanitarian assistance continue. He urged all those in the affected areas to move to safer grounds to avert loss of lives.
We have established an evacuation camp at Ombaka. There are people now there and more people are still coming. We have sent out an appeal for emergency support, either food and non-food items, both to the national and county government, and we're expecting assistance as from tomorrow. We have also alerted the National Disaster Response Center, and it's our hope that the affected families will soon get support.
Kisumu County Director of Public Health Liliana Dayo said medical personnel have been dispatched to the affected areas to control spread of malaria and waterborne diseases. Tilio Marco for Prime Edition.
Floods wreak havoc in Kisumu. That story brings us to a second break right here on Prime Edition. Don't go away. We'll be back shortly. Stay with us.
To get Schizotune Hail Mary, dial *811. *963#.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
To get Hail Mary, dial *811. *963#. *811. *963#.
Biggest odds in the world every day on selected matches. Make a decision. Mozart Bet.
Welcome to Take on Tech. This is the show that keeps you updated on everything you need to know about technology.
First of all, the women that are already in tech should be empowered.
I've actually studied electrical and electronics engineering, telecommunications option. So basically I'm in the tech sector.
The government should empower the girl child in a way that they should venture so much into ICT.
There's never a dull moment with us. Tune in every Monday from 10:30 p.m. only on KBC Channel 1.
Welcome back. Residents from Machaka informal settlement in Buri, that's in Meru County, have expressed reservations with government housing project in that area. The residents say that despite the project being a noble idea, they will not be able to afford the houses. Elsewhere, Embu residents have decried high water tariffs following a move by the Water Regulatory Authority to implement a section of the act that was passed way back in 2021. This and more in our county news roundup.
Machaka slums in Buri, Meru County. Residents say they would love to see the area undergo a facelift, but the cost involved in the acquisition of new houses is too much for them. They called on the government to relook into the affordable housing program.
Sasa sina nguvu ya kutafuta pesa, ninalala njaa, nitapata pesa ya nyumba au nitapata pesa ya chakula. Tunakataa nyumba, tunasema hiyo manyumba wanataka kutujengia. Wapange hiyo pesa, waweke mzuri, watutafutie mahali pa kukaa.
Meanwhile, tension is high in Kinanduba village at the border of Meru and Isiolo counties following the killing of a former MCA by suspected bandits. In Naivasha, Nakuru County, residents of Lakeview Estate are appealing to the government to beef up security following a spike in criminal activities in the area.
Hali ya usalama imekuwa ikitutatiza kwa miezi kadhaa sasa. Nasikia manyumba imevujwa na sasa hata ile kitu ya kuchagaza sana ni kwamba naonekana hata mchana ndio wanapendelea sana kwa sababu nyumba nyingi hivi karibuni zimevujwa wakati wa mchana.
Finally, Embu residents have decried high water tariffs following a move by the Water Regulatory Authority to implement a section of the act that was passed in 2021. They say the increment of the tariffs from 50 cents to 5 shillings per cubic meter of water is not affordable with the current economic challenges.
Na sasa nasikia pesa ya maji imetoka imeongezeka na 600%. 900%. That is not acceptable. Kwa sababu sheria inaweka kinagaubaga kwamba kitu yoyote ambayo inaguza maisha ya wananchi lazima ifanyiwe kitu inaitwa public.
He served as Voi legislator for 20 consecutive years, that's between 1969 all the way to 1998, during the one-party system, those who can remember. Over that period, he served in both the founding father Mzee Jomo Kenyatta and his successor Daniel Moi's cabinet. On tonight's segment of the cabinet, we focus on Eliud Timothy Mwamunga.
Born on 21st July 1935 in Ishamba at the foot of Taita Hills, Eliud Timothy Mwamunga built himself a reputation as an astute politician, adept at navigating the choppy waters of government. His political career began in 1969 after he contested and won the Voi parliamentary seat. In 1974, he was re-elected and appointed by President Jomo Kenyatta as the Minister for Water Development. During his two-year stint in the ministry, Mamunga spearheaded projects that included the construction of the country's first dams, water supply schemes for urban areas, and irrigation schemes that boosted agricultural production. In 1976, Kenyatta switched Mamunga with Gekonyo Kiano, who had been in charge of the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. In 1979 general election, Mamunga recaptured his Voi parliamentary seat in spite of an uneasy relationship with Moi due to his links with ministers and businessmen close to Kenyatta. Mamunga was reappointed to the cabinet as Minister for Information and Broadcasting. In 1983, however, he fell out with President Moi, marking the beginning of his exit from government. In 1988, he was sacked as the Minister for Information and Broadcasting and later dethroned by Adiel Kachila as Voi MP. Many MPs perceived to be anti-Moi lost their seats. As the national purge continued, Mamunga lost his chairmanship of the Taita Taveta Kanu branch and was later suspended from membership in the branch. In 1992, however, Mamunga joined Kibaki to launch the Democratic Party after the constitution was changed in 1991 to allow multi-party politics. He was named the DP Coast representative, and he played an active role in popularizing the new party. However, the division in the newly formed opposition parties made it difficult for them to win the elections. Mamunga himself lost in the Voi parliamentary election. He then retired from active politics and retreated to Ishamba to concentrate on business and farming. Mamunga would then struggle with ill health until his demise on June 9, 2018, at the age of 83. Jacqueline Masharia for The Cabinet.
Well, there are those, of course, who can remember that it was a Saturday in the morning when we lost Mwamunga, an Okchegerian who lost his Voi parliamentary seat to Darius and not Daniel Bella. We're going to take our third break right here on Prime Edition. When we come back, Daniel Wahome, is coming right up with the day sports. So stay with us.
Daring pilot and earn by how much high you can lift the plane. The higher you fly, the higher your wind. The sky is the limit. Mozart Bet.
It is Nuremberg at home against Stuttgart, and this is a repeat of the final almost 16 years ago.
VfB Stuttgart's 1-0 win over FC Nuremberg secured them a place in the last four for the first time since reaching the final in 2013.
And this is Enzo Milo. Enzo Milo to score! The substitute has done it! And he's done it in style!
On the other hand, Eintracht Frankfurt's 2-0 home win over Union Berlin kept the Europa League holders on track for what will be a sixth German Cup win and the first since 2018. Witness this interesting semi-final DFB Pokal match between VfB Stuttgart and Eintracht Frankfurt kicking off at 9:45 p.m. on Wednesday, 3rd of May. KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Sports News is brought to you by Mozart Bet. Kurumisha Ndege, Avieta Instant Game. Be a daring pilot and earn by how much high you can lift the plane. The higher you fly, the higher your win. The sky is the limit. Mozart Bet.
A very good evening to you. My name is Daniel Wahome and welcome to Prime Edition Sports on Labor Day 2023. The Football Kenya Federation Premier League matches will resume tomorrow with one match on the card. 2009 champion Sofapaka will target to gather maximum points when they face host Vihiga Bullet at the Bukhungu Stadium in Kakamega County.
Bullets coach Luis Kizito is confident that his side will not be relegated at the end of the Football Kenya Federation Premier League season, despite their miserable run. Vihiga Bullets will host Sofapaka FC Tuesday at Bukungu Stadium. Vihiga's charges are last on the log with 8 points, while David Zouma's side are 13th on the log with 28 points. On Wednesday, AFC Leopards will play Ulinzi Stars, Nzoia Sugar host Talanta FC, Police will be up against Bidco United, Homeboys will tackle Wazito while KCB face Bandari FC. For Channel 1 Sports, I'm Sila Onyango.
Now, Bandari have sacked coach Anthony Modukemani following the 3-0 Mozart Bet Cup defeat suffered at the hands of AFC Leopards at the Kasarani Stadium. His time at the Coastal-based club came to an end after 2 years and 2 months of service. Bandari Chief Executive Officer Edward Oduor confirmed that the axe had fallen on the former Kenyan international, with veteran tactician Sheikh Twahir Muhyiddin taking charge in the remaining matches in the current campaign. The former Harambee Stars defender joined Bandari in February 2021 to deputize Rwandese tactician Andre Kasambungo, whom he had worked with at AFC Leopards. Bandari are 19 points behind Football Kenya Federation Premier League leaders Gor Mahia. Now, Masi Nyanchama emerged as the overall gross winner of the second edition of the Karen Ladies Open, held at the Karen Golf and Country Club. The tournament brought together over 200 top lady golfers from across the country.
The Vetlab Club player garnered 78 gross on count back, beating Karen's Luisa Gitau, who came in second. Agnes Nyakeo came in third with 79 gross. In the Division A net category, Wayua Mululu emerged top with 72 net, beating Naomi Kimata on count back. Rachel Ondei came in third with 74 net, beating Dorcas Balanya on count back. Meanwhile, Nyawira Masharia was the star among the juniors with 75 net.
And we believe that through this sponsorship, we will be able to help support women golfers to showcase their skill, as well as inspire the next generation of golfers. So we do recognize the importance of supporting women's golf in Kenya.
The tournament brought together over 200 top lady golfers from across the country. For Prime Edition Sports, I'm Daniel Mwendo.
Now let's move across our borders now, where two-time Africa Cup of Nations under 17 champions Nigeria bagged maximum points after a 1-0 win over Zambia at the 2023 under 17 AFCON in Constantine, Algeria. Meanwhile, Morocco also registered a win after a 2-0 victory over South Africa in their Group B opener.
Favour Daniel gave Nigeria the lead in the 76th minute after both teams missed open chances in the first half, forcing a goalless half-time draw.
The ball breaks in the air, it's pulled for a handball, and there's the opening goal for Nigeria. Daniel finally breaks the deadlock.
The goal was enough to give Nigeria, who are this year's title favourite, all 3 points. In another match, Morocco also registered a win after 2-0 victory over South Africa in Group B opener.
And yes! It's perfect, and it's 1-0 Morocco.
And still hope.
to equalize, even if Amani crossed the ball. Oh my God, what an error! And the second goal for Morocco now!
Morocco will take on Golden Eagles on Wednesday in their second Group B game. Meanwhile, defender Salim Fall volleyed home 12 minutes to time as Senegal registered 1-0 victory over Congo.
A few yards out, giving Senegal a deserved victory, really. After all the chances they created, it ended up being a centre-back who...
Now let's move stateside, where Stephen Curry and two reigning NBA champions, the Golden State Warriors, avoided an early playoff exit with a masterclass in the series decider at the Sacramento Kings. Curry hit a playoff career high 50 points as his side won 120 points to 100.
Opening round playoff series. Beautiful pass, Draymond Green to Kevon Looney, and they get on the board first. Kevin Herter knocks down a three.
The Kings, who were making their postseason appearance in 17 years and had the benefit of a home crowd, led 58-56 at halftime with Domantas Sabonis scoring 16 points.
Jumper for Harrison Barnes. Looney and Curry play catch. Curry, that's his first three.
But that quarter belonged to the Warriors, and once again, Curry scored 5 points in a row to put them 69-62 up with 7 minutes and 50 seconds remaining. They seized control and never let it go.
And that's what Steve Kerr was talking about.
Fox searching. Now, jump shot. That's his.
Curry was devastating with 7 three-pointers in his tally, but Kevon Looney, Andrew Wiggins, and Klay Thompson also played their parts in the win.
Momentarily, they flipped it in off the glass. Curry finds Draymond Green, runs and finishes.
The Warriors will face LeBron James' LA Lakers in the Western Conference semifinals.
Fox lines that one up, nails a three-pointer. Curry, long distance, that's good.
Well, that's the sport for tonight. Join us for more sport tomorrow. And like we mentioned in our premier story, is that Sofapaka are playing against Vihiga Bullets at the Buhungu Stadium in Kakamega County. My name is Daniel Wahome. I'll be back shortly with Tom Boyer because he's asking some tough questions about wind assist in sprint races. Coming back in a short while.
News was brought to you by Mozart Bet.
Nafasi yako ya kuwa mdosi wako. Jiunge na washindi tufanye biashara. Kuwa mshindi. Mozart Bet.
Why are you here?
Long time no see.
My God.
Everyone, I officially announce, as of today, Larry has been promoted to the position of general manager. Welcome!
How come you're here?
Remember I said I would take the interview? So now you know that I'm diviner.
And you?
How pathetic that two bachelors know each other so well. So, before our relationship gets too awkward, I'm going to leave.
What am I forgetting? Nini, workers paid, rent checked, mlango locked, visiting out of office, internet sorted. What is it? What am I forgetting?
Nini, nimesahau kucheza Lotto Moto.
Usisahau kucheza Lotto Moto. Unaweza shinda hadi milioni mbili. Kwenye M-Pesa, chagua lipa na M-Pesa. Paybill number, weka 7577. Account number, weka neno, loto. Weka kiwango chochote cha pesa, kuanzia shilingi 50 hadi 2000. Lipa, kisha subiri draw. Ujumbe huu, uidhinishwa na BCLP.
Last season's finalists clash head to head.
Comes here to Hoffler!
That's excellent. And Werner's finish.
A chance for Leipzig to save their season.
It is for Freiburg.
It's Willy Orban!
Freiburg's second semi-final in a row. Who will get to the final? Freiburg out for revenge against Leipzig.
There you are. Now, Dan.
Yes.
You know when I saw 9.78 on Manyala, I couldn't believe it. I was super excited. In fact, I remember almost tossing over, you know. And then later on, I had some people talking about wind assist, and they lost me there. What's all this about? What is it? Explain it to me. Explain it to my grandmother in the village.
Okay, this is how it works.
Yeah.
For the 100 meters,
yeah.
The 200 meters,
yeah.
And the hurdles,
yeah.
110 meters for men and 100 meters for women. Mm. What happens is you consider that you're running in a straight line.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what happens. You have wind coming from behind you. That wind is calculated with plus two plus this.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can have wind coming against you. That is considered minus. Any wind that is minus does not affect your time and the implication. So now, this is what happens. Yeah. The maximum legitimate wind is plus 2 meters per second.
Mm-hmm.
So it's coming behind you. So ideally, it gives you a slight push. So at times, you can have some very strong winds. I remember during the under 18 World Championships in 2017,
yeah,
they had to stop some of the throws and some of the jumps.
Because of the wind?
Because the wind at Kasarani at one point, it rained and the wind was so heavy, it was doing 7 meters per second.
Uh-huh.
So it's not, especially for javelin and things like that, it's not safe.
Yeah.
So ideally, that is how it works. But in the case of Manyala, his wind was plus 2.3 meters per second. Uh-huh. It's above the allowable one, plus 2 meters per second. So those people who do the mathematics around this.
So that is a clean assist.
So they simply say this is an assist.
Okay.
So at 2 meters per second, they say the difference between 9.78 and 9.79 is not huge.
Okay.
But without that plus 0.3 meters per second,
yeah,
it probably would have been a time of 9.80.
Okay.
So ideally what the wind from behind does is that it gives you a push.
Tell me, remember there was that race where I think it was a Kenyan and an Ethiopian, and the Kenyan was almost getting to the finishing line and this Ethiopian came from behind. All right, and I think the Kenyan lost it and he slapped the guy. You remember
actually,
that?
The Ethiopian is Haile Gebrselassie.
Selassie, yes, isn't it?
And this was at a youth championships. We're talking about 30 years ago.
Yeah.
So when Haile Gebrselassie got past him,
yeah,
he went and pushed him. So
did that affect the end result?
Yes. He lost his silver medal. He was disqualified.
Who? The guy who pushed?
Yes, the Kenyan. I don't know why his name has slipped my mind, but I know the story.
So was there
any... He was disqualified because of unsporting conduct.
That's fine. But in terms of the...
In fact, he gave an assist to Haile Gebrselassie.
Yeah, so that's what I wanted.
But it was rough. So he lost it.
It was... Okay.
It was rough.
Yeah.
Haile Gebrselassie won it.
Yeah.
I think it was an under 20 championship.
You
were talking about 23 years. I mean, we're talking about when? Around 90. It's early 90s.
It's a while. It's been some time.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
So that was the case.
Yeah.
So there is unsporting conduct.
So he pushed him.
He actually pushed him, aided him, but the action was considered unsporting.
Yeah.
And so he admits.
So he got punished.
He got punished.
What about Gebrselassie?
Because that was a push.
He took the gold.
Because the unsporting conduct went against him. For example, if you tackle somebody inside the box in a football game and he goes on to score a penalty, do you punish the person who was tackled because alikupatia chobo?
No, but he was aided, Bana.
No, he wasn't aided. The action was...
That was a push, Bana.
No, the action was that he actually slapped him on the back and pushed him.
Yeah.
That video is there on YouTube.
Yeah.
It's quite an iconic one.
Yeah.
Anyway,
he was punished, and We didn't punish.
Actually, he says it was naivety.
We didn't punish Gabriel Selassie, but we punished Omanyala.
No, we've punished Gabriel Selassie by taking all his world records in the marathon.
All right, thank you. We got to go now. Thanks.
All right.
Yeah? You want to start it off?
Daniel Wahome. All right. Remember that for the next 2 days, 9:45 p.m., the best of German knockout football is coming in. It's the semifinals of the DFB Pokal. SC Freiburg are in action tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
Yeah.
And we're coming back tomorrow anyway. So.
And we'll be back tomorrow. So yeah. Tomorrow at 9:40 we'll be out. 9:45 p.m. Tuesday and Wednesday. Look out for that on your True Sports partner, KBC Channel 1. My name is Daniel Wahome. Have a good evening.
I'm Tom Boyer. Good night. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Semi-final in a row. Who will get to the final? Freiburg out for revenge against Leipzig.
You and I are over. Because I am not the woman who will make you happy. I'm not that woman.
That if someday you finally understand that the one and only way for you to be happy is to be with me. Because I do love you, Fabiola. You know where you can find me.
Yes, I know you hate me, but I also know you love me. And if you weigh your feelings, you'll know which one is going to make you happy.
But when that day comes, when you finally realize what's true, I'm not yet tired waiting for you.
KBC Channel 1. We put people at the heart of events with our captivating weekly news features. Every day, we are breaking new grounds with informative, entertaining, and inspiring human interest stories. On Mondays, 9 p.m., we have The Cabinet. Tuesday, 9 p.m., we get inside the barracks for military tales. Delve in the world of cinemas and theater each Wednesday night. For the young and industrious, make a date with us every Thursday at 9 p.m. Fridays are dedicated for my culture. On Saturdays, we go back in time for history in perspective. And on Sundays, we get to know the process of how things are done and made. KBC Channel 1 News features a whole lot of wonderful viewing experience.
Sauti ya Kenya 92.9. Hii ni KBC Radio Taifa.
Kila kitu maishani kina sauti yaleta furaha.
Radio.
Thank you.
guy. Now only we wala. Yes, better act like you know that we are your only plug when it comes to entertainment. How you doing?
Wagwan, Nairobi kama kawaida. Yani tonight it's gonna be lit, Miss Bia. From Nairobi all the way to Mombasa. Alafu tuko na sherehe zote hapa.
Sherehe zili sherehe round this.
Trust me, it's gonna be a big night, man.
Tell a friend of yours to tell an enemy if they're not tuned in. They better do that because we have a proper show lined up for you. My name is Vivian Dago. You can simply just call me Miss V.
Jacques Mula, the party daddy.co.ke.
AKA
your girlfriend, go my digits, Miss V. Took a holiday mood. What's a really nice one,
Zay? Yeah, and you know what this right here is?
Grapevine, baby.
The Male Festival organized by the Mo Ibrahim Foundation is taking place right here at the Kenya International Convention Center, KICC. Let me tell you guys that their lineup today is absolutely star-studded, from the likes of Nyashinsky, Major Nvi, the storyteller, DJ John Falme, you name them. You are absolutely going to love this. Let's go inside and check it out.
On Saturday, Kenya hosted the Mo Festival at the KICC. The event is part of the Mo Ibrahim Foundation's annual Ibrahim Governance Weekend. The Mo Ibrahim Foundation is an African organization promoting sound leadership and governance to transform the lives of Africa's citizens. It is also anchored by the goal of championing Africa's youth participation in the continent's development. On this day, though, it was all about celebrating African music and culture. Those in attendance got to enjoy an evening of nothing but Greek music. The star-studded lineup featured the likes of Nyashinsky, Nvi the Storyteller, Major, among others. DJ Piero McKenna had sets in between performances, and she definitely set the place ablaze with her fire mixes. Major, as is his usual, gave a back-to-back performance of some of his major hits, including Ego, which is his most recent release. Nviri, backed by his all-girl band aside from the keyboard player, soothed the crowd with his mellow tunes. From Kitenge, Badae to Pombe Sigara, the entire performance was spectacular. The closing act of the night was none other than Nyashinsky. The talented and versatile artist, as is his norm, never disappoints, and he continues to ascertain why he is one of Kenya's most dynamic performers. Nyashinsky's performance seemed endless as he went on and on performing some of his fans' favorites. He got off the stage at 1:10 a.m. before DJ Joe Falme and Hype Ballo took over to close off the night. That was one eventful and seamlessly running show.
Our spotlight artist this week, we feature none other than Stone Boy, all the way from Accra, Ghana. Man, Stone Boy dropped a 17 track album. Hey, manze, I'm a feature, you know, big artist, manze, from Davido, Shaggy, name them, manze. Without wasting time, let's check it out.
Ghanaian dancehall superstar Stone Boy released his much anticipated album last Friday, dubbed Fifth Dimension. Fifth Dimension is a collection of sounds that showcase the Grammy nominee's ability to seamlessly fuse different genres and cultures into his music. The album boasts 17 songs. This becomes the BET Award winner's fifth album after Grade 1, Necessary Evil, the Billboard-rated Epistles of Mama, and 2020's Reggae Vile Album of the Year, Anloga Junction. His Fifth Dimension album, Stone Boy, scripted and recorded it during exclusive sessions across Europe, America, and Africa, where he featured top African artists like Davido, Oxlade, and Tiwa Savage, all from Nigeria, alongside the